Inshallah, tonight we will speak about a major challenge that our Ummah and our region is facing, and a proposed solution, just still in the incubation period, that we have proposed to contribute, not to solve, we cannot solve, but just to contribute to solving this problem. And it is to open the discussion and welcome your feedback and input, because the project still in its infancy stage and require lots of input and contribution from everybody. This project is not owned by anybody, it's by certain people, but it's owned by all of us. This is our worry, and inshallah I hope that this will be our solution, that all of us contribute to it. The title of the presentation is Leadership Deficit. Let me tell you, in Savola Group, where I've been working for the last 10 years, we have expanded from doing business in one country, Saudi Arabia, to doing business in 16 countries. Maybe Savola Group is one of the few companies that became a multinational company, but originated from an Arab or a Muslim country. And one key challenge that we have faced in Savola, every time we have a new proposition or a new opportunity in any country, that we cannot find calibers or leaders who are capable to take charge of these new opportunities. Always we have to move people like chess pieces, let us find somebody, or we go and headhunt from other companies. And many people have headhunted from Savola. So we have few people in the community who are calibers and good leaders that you can depend on them, and all the companies are headhunting them from one company to the other. But really in the pipeline, we need pipelines of leaders that can take a charge of making a real development, both at economic and social aspects of our economy. We speak out why we thought of MILE, what is it, and how we will achieve its objective, where it's going to be, and what are the first two programs that we have started. So why we need MILE? Because of this topic of today, which is leadership deficit. There are so many reports, several reports and the statistics that show that a shortage of competent emerging leader is a major constraint for economic and social growth in our region. Look at many of the reports that has been published. It says this region will never develop as long as it does not invest in developing its future leaders. Examples of these reports, I will not go in details, but this is just example. This is a report, it's called the Arab Business Intelligence Report, developed by PricewaterhouseCoopers. You know, this is the main finding, you cannot read them, but this is the one that we need to focus on. The Arab business world regards loss of key talent as a major threat to its growth prospects. So who steals them? How do you lose them? They go to other companies. So this is what I was talking about. Another, you know, the same reports, when they ask the executives in the interview, what do you consider to be the highest priorities for your business in order to improve competitive performance over the next 12 months. Number one, that among all the executives that have interviewed them, came improving people. After this, reducing cost, operation, maximizing return, strategy definition, innovation, they came all next to the most important one, which is improving people resources. Another report, very popular one, called the Arab Human Development Reports. Believe me, I was reading this yesterday. You will cry when you read this. That really, you know, give you a profile of the condition of the human development in our regions. This is some of the statistics. It's a big report, but I just took one graph. This is perception of corruption in the Arab world. When they ask people about to what extent do you think there is a corruption, very few people say there is no corruption, it's a clean society, and most of the people say it's highly corrupted environments. Another report called the Arab Knowledge Report 2009, another interesting report. Some of the findings with their comparison of overall results of students in Arab countries and students in the United States on business administration test. So when they give the same test to Arab and American student, this was the score that the Arab scored. This is fail and this excellent. And this was the score of the American. I put this in a graph to make it more representable. So the Arab, the scores of the Arab, the blue came here, and the scores of the American came this curve. In fact, when I graduated from my bachelor degree back in 1976 in Cairo University, I was graduated according to a dean, one of the dean of the Alexandria University. I went to visit him to start my master's degree. He told me that in the history of Egyptian universities, you have achieved the highest grade in your graduation. Fadlillah, takhassus, my specialty, because we have accounting and business. Usually the people who are bad in mathematics and they don't hit numbers and their scores are very weak throughout the first 3 years, they end, you know, they go to business administration. And but the smart one, they go to accounting. So I went to business administration. My grade was distinction with the honor degree, Imtiaz Ma'amartaf Sharaf al-Ula. And the president of Egypt gave me a plaque award, the plaque of excellence in business administration from President Sadat. I was very happy, Rasi Kibrit the Megulum, you know, I thought very high of myself. When I submitted for my application to study at Wharton School of University of Pennsylvania, which is one of the top Ivy League universities, I was in a class of PhD students of about 20 students. Next to me, Shum'on bin Gud'on from Israel, Renato Di Matta from Philippines, you know, from all the corners of the globe, 20 students. In the first week, after we started discussion and listening to the lecture, I have ranked myself to be at the bottom of this group. And the distance between me and the next one is a big distance. 90% of what the professor is saying just fly above my head. I don't understand what's happening. They can follow up. I can hardly follow up. So I am the smart one and the best one in Egypt, but when you put me in comparison and benchmark with others, this, you know, I discovered that we have not, they have not taught me anything. I have to spend tons of hours at night to catch up studying undergraduate courses. Now I was thinking, you know, alhamdulillah, I made it in 4 years. I had 2 masters and 1 PhD, fadlillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what I was thinking of, my colleagues who graduated with me with a passing grade and good grade, where are they now? They are managers of hospitals, banks, insurance companies, manufacturing, retail. So if I could not compete with my, you know, the my benchmark with other, you know, PhD students being graduated from Egyptian university, how can these people manage their companies and compete globally with other companies? They cannot. The quality of business schools in our part of the world is so poor to the extent that we cannot even dare to claim that we can have a competitive edge or we can be competitive, you know, global competitive in the, with the other institution. This is a graph which is number of scientific papers published in the Arab region. This is Egypt only, and this is the rest of the Arab region. And look, you know, this is the total publications per year. There is another graph that shows Arab now account for 1.1% of global scientific publishing. All the publications that come from people of Arab origin constitute only 1.1% of the world publication. Many other reports, United Nations Development Program, International Monetary Fund, the Global Competitiveness Report, the latest one, the Arab Human Challenge Report, even, you know, the African, you know, this is there is a big leadership deficit as well, and there is a comparison between two leadership styles. This is a very interesting graph that shows IQ distribution. IQ is the intelligent quotient that measures how intelligent the person is. And as you can see here, all the intelligent people are in North America, Europe, and China. And look, our region, these are the Muslim and Arab countries. This is the lowest grades of intelligence. The question is that, till when can we continue with this condition? There is a popular saying, one definition of insanity is to continue doing the same thing and expect different results. أحد تعريفات الجنون إنك تستمر في عمل نفس الشيء وتتوقع نتائج أحسن ونتائج مختلفة. If you keep doing what you are doing, you will keep getting what you are getting. If this is the condition, and we, our universities continue to be the same, our in-house training continue to be the same, our professional societies like Ashram continue to be the same, working at, you know, low-skill level, so how the quantum jump in our performance come from? Huh? So that's why we have to do it. So I have here 5 observations or root causes behind this deteriorating factor when we talk about leadership in the business context. I'm not talking about leadership in political context, and I'm talking about leadership in the business context. First, You know, this is in reference to the story I said about my grade, and I was the top of Egypt, but compared to other people, I was very low. This is why low quality of local business school. The recent research of financialtimes.com just came 3-4 weeks ago, but this was last year report of the ranking of the top universities. This is the ranking of the top executive education program, 65 top world executive education program. I categorized them by country, not by school. And the result was zero of them is located in an Arab or a Muslim country. Not in Malaysia, not in Turkey, not in Egypt, not in Iran, not in Emirates, not in any of those countries. What about top 100 business schools in the world? I categorize them by, out of the 100 top business schools, there is 56 of them in USA, and there is 18 in UK, and the rest among the rest of the world. How many of them in a Muslim or Arab country? Zero. We don't have none of them. So first cause is our business school education is not up to par. Number two, lack of corporate universities or what we call in-house training programs. Alhamdulillah, in Savola, I established Savola Academy to, you know, to give training program and sharpen the competencies of our intermediate level and, you know, middle management levels and entry levels. In Banda, same thing, you know. We worked with Abdurrahman al-Rafai to establish Banda Academy. But not all companies of the size of Savola and Banda have the resources to build their in-house training. In-house training you can invest if you are very large, if you have the economies of scale. The multinational company, the Procter & Gamble and Unilever and Nestle and HB and all of these countries, they are huge. They are all over the world. They have hundreds of thousands of people working for them. So it's worthwhile investing in their in-house training to train them. But small companies, they cannot afford to do this. They can just hire simple HR person for induction, for basic safety, you know, training, presentation skills, and so on. So our organization lacks the required economies of scale, qualified local training and development resources, and the networking and professional training and development societies. We don't have much. We are here in Jeddah and we have Ashram Society. But what about the people in Yambo or in Abha or in Mansoura in Egypt or in Marrakesh or Tanja? And most of the in-house training focus in the entry level or the intermediate, you know, level of management. Very few of the in-house training, if they exist, focus on the top management. In fact, in Savola every year, we send 4 or 5 people to INSEAD or to Harvard to attend the executive education program. There is no other place we can send them to in our region. Few days ago, I have an HR manager of one of the local banks visiting me. He told me that they have spent during the last 4 years, 7 million Saudi riyal to train 40 of their managers. When I did the mathematics, it is. This is how much it cost. 7 million Saudi riyal only to train 40 managers. And how do you classify this 7 million? CapEx or OPEX? It's operational expense or capital expenditure? I consider it operational expense because the money gone. I don't have trainers, I don't have training packages, I don't have case studies, I don't have in-house capabilities to continue to develop this, to deliver the same service. If you look at the big, even local companies like Aramco, I know many people here from Aramco, and they may disagree with me. This is from the website of Aramco, when they speak about their local training and so on, so that the type of training, when you go through the websites, it's mainly focused. Most of the executive training in Aramco, I have met many of them at Wharton School. When I was visiting Wharton School, I found a couple of them. I asked them, they said, we have a contract throughout the years. In fact, they have officer in the United States just to look after the executive training, and they have major contracts with different business schools. When you look at the corporate university exchange, it is a corporation in the United States that allow networking and exchange of experiences of companies, of in-house corporate universities. And these are the logos of the member, you know, big corporation, multinational company who have big, what we can call corporate university. I found only one, Arabic or a Muslim one, which is Sabic. And I don't know really to what extent they focus on technical training versus executive training. Here is my focus on the executive training.